for coming along to this tonight lecture organized by King Faisal Center for Islamic and Research Studies. I would like first and foremost to welcome His Royal Highness Prince Turki Faisal and his delegation for being here. It's my pleasure to welcome Professor Alexey Vasiliev. He's the honorary president of the Institute of African Studies and the head of the chair of the Arab and African Studies of the People's Friendship University of Russia. And he has numerous books written about the history of the Middle East, as well as politics, as extremism and terrorism. His latest but not least book, hopefully, Russia and the Middle East, from Vladimir Lenin to Vladimir Putin, Russia Foreign Policy in the Middle East. I think we're going to have undoubtedly an important topic tonight. We have roughly 40 minutes, then we have the A&Q discussion. So the floor is yours now.
Shukran jazilin. يسعدني وهذا الشرف كبير بالنسبة لي أن أتكلم قدام هذه النخبة من الباحثين العرب السعوديين قدام سمو الأمير من العائلة المشهورة وإنني أفتخر أنني كنت مؤلفا لكتاب عن الملك فيصل الشخصية المرموقة ومترجمة إلى ثلاث لغات وأنا أفتخر بهذا يعني وبعدين اسمحوا لي رغم أنني أستطيع أن أتكلم إلى حد ما باللغة العربية أن أتكلم بالإنجليزي هذا بالنسبة لي أبسط و so, with your permission, I'll speak English because there are, as I know, very good interpreters, very good translators, and it will be easier for me at least to express my ideas. So, I would like to say a few words about this book because it was published already in Arabic in Egypt. And it was published in Russian and in English. I hope it is now in the way of being translated into Chinese. Well, you see, I am of an opinion that even scientific books or some researches should be written in a way to interest the readers. So this book is based on a number of sources, official sources, diplomatic sources, but at the same time on the interviews with approximately, I would say 40 people, maybe more, including Russian Prime Minister Primakov, including a number of foreign ministers, diplomats, researchers and so on. So I hope that it could be of interest for readers. Well, to start what I'm writing in this book, I will start from the very end, let us say last events in the Middle East, for example, chemical problems in Syria. You see, I hope we are here for rules of Chatham House. So what I share with you, I just for you, not for publication, but I would start from the end. It means, well, there were some stories or fairy tales about chemical attacks in Syria and what could be the reaction. My daughter, who works in the business of financial business, he phoned to me and say, so what shall be there after that? What will be there after it? I say, look, there it is on my telephone. I said, well, first of all, Mr. Trump has to pretend that he is striking Syria. Then Mr. Putin will pretend that he is angry and he will go to the United Nations. So I said it 3-5 days ago So as you see, I was right. Why? And now about chemical attack. You see, I have an idea. Well, I would say a mild Russian nationalist. And for example, I would say that maybe the role of Lenin in Russian history was more negative than positive. But anyhow, he was a genius in politics, in logic. So he said that if something takes place and you don't know good or criminal case, who has organized it, just you should think in the interest of whom this was taking place. And we study this story of so-called chemical attack in Duma. There is always a question. Well, they say, the mass media, and then it was repeated by a lot of heads of states and so on, that it was done by the Syrian regime in Duma. But, by the way, it was agreement of evacuation of all the armed opposition group from this place outside. It's a long story, but still it was decided. And then immediately Russian military police, not army, but military police, would come there, and after that, official Syrian authorities. Why should it be the interest of Syria to organize chemical something if in 2 days they would control this small city? Why? Was it in the interest of Syria? Was it in the interest of Russia? I would say no. Well, let us suppose that this chemical attack took place. In the interest of whom? The answer, well, maybe I am wrong, but the answer for on my part is that it could be in the interest of the armed opposition, who would like to have some Western powers to bomb their way to power, as it was done in Libya several years ago. The second who is interested is, of course, Western countries or leaders who would pretend that they would show to the world how strong they are, how resolute they are, and how they would say, Russia, well, we are not glad with your participation in Syria conflicts, especially Russia was rather successful. It was not victory, but it's another story, but it was successful. So that's my explanation. But the question is much wider. The question is, did this so-called chemical attack take place at all? Or it was just imagination of mass media and some sort of masrahiya, of theatrical something which was organized not in Duma but somewhere else? I would say, how it's possible? Is it possible? Is it possible so many lies, so many fake news? Well, I would say, look, very interesting indeed, but the fact is, it is not the first time in history. Look, would you ask me to give example of the Middle East? American and English intervention in Iraq in 2003. Before it, there was, well, during his electoral election campaign, Mr. Trump said that President Bush was lying at that time. It's not me. Trump said this. It's not all that. Do you remember this old story when foreign minister of the United States, Powell, he was at the UN Security Council, was taking some small bottle with something and said, look, there is some bacteriological component in it. Of course, it was very dangerous. If it was really that, and he would just break it, well, all the people in this small room after that would be dead. But there was some powder in it, and it was not serious. But it is not enough. Some group of American journalists counted, I don't know exactly, it's written in my book, officially that there were more than 700 or 800 times than American administration just lied about possibility of arms of mass destruction in Iraq, so the war started. By the way, no Arab state, not a single one, participated in this military intervention except Kuwait. He could not stand aside. Saudi Arabian leadership was very, very clever also not to participate in this intervention. So let us now, I started at the very end, I could give you a lot of examples of these official lies. For example, before Vietnam War, and by the way, I was at my time, I was a Pravda correspondent in Vietnam during the war, and saw with my own eyes when the plane with McCain pilot was shot down. I saw it with, so poor McCain, he spent five years in Vietnamese prison, and since that time, he still hates communists, he still Russians, Chinese, and continues to hate them. I think he's a little bit already. Well, but sometimes you see, just permit me just for a couple of sentences to return to what I was telling about today's something about chemical attacks and also. You see, when I look at the face of Mr. Johnson, foreign minister of Britain, well, he looks as if he is not a foreign minister, he is something from, excuse me, I don't want to be bad with him, from circus or something like that. But he is very clever. I saw his book before he became foreign minister and said, look, he wrote in this book, in the very difficult situation, just to put the attention of people outside it, what should you do? Take a dead cat with bad smell and put it on the table. And immediately all the attention would be put to this cat and not to the problems you are discussing about. He wrote it. Very clever man. Well, by the way, so let us continue the serious things. I would like to speak about history, and I wrote about it, of relations between the Soviet Union and Russia, and then Saudi Arabia. Well, foreign policy of Russia in the Middle East and in general was combination of messianism of communism distribution in the world and state pragmatism. It was the same with Saudi Arabia. There were some ideas to distribute, excuse my English, some communist ideas during Hajj time in Saudi Arabia. But at the same time, the Soviet Union was the first country in the world to recognize the new reality, new kingdom, which was called at the beginning Nejd, Hijaz, or some other territories. The Soviet Union was the first to recognize it. Then the Soviet Union invited the then foreign minister Emir Faisal to visit the Soviet Union. So you could imagine that in this country, which officially proclaimed atheism, there was reception of Emir Faisal with the with the flag of Saudi Arabia, in which it was written La ilaha illallah wa Muhammad Rasulullah. But it was the fact. So it was mixture of two things together. And then during time before the World War II, there was no interest of the Soviet Union toward Saudi Arabia, and practically the relations were not cut, they were stopped. They were stopped for many, many years. And when time came that necessity to reestablish these relations, once during some reception in Afghanistan, when King Faisal visited Afghanistan, he was approached during the reception by the Soviet ambassador. He said, let us reestablish our relation. King Faisal said, when you refused your atheism, we are ready next day to establish relations with them. So time came, though, of course, Saudi leadership was also pragmatic. It had very good relations with India, in spite of the fact that Indians, they say that they have about 30 million gods. It's not me who say it, they say it. And then with China, that there is no god at all in their ideology, in their religion. But anyhow, well, nowadays it's much easier because Mr. Putin is very religious man, and he helps the church in all ways. But anyhow, when there was Saddam Hussein aggression against Kuwait, it was a possibility to reestablish relations. And of course, two countries did not know each other well enough, but still it was difficult to understand each other. But as I mentioned, when there was military intervention in Iraq, which was against interest, including interest of Saudi Arabia, the relations started to warmer, to warm, to become warmer and warmer. There were visits of the then Herr Emir Abdallah to Russia. Then after his famous Munich speech, in 2007, the first country to visit after his speech, Mr. Putin came to Saudi Arabia, and even he made all the women who accompanied him, he directed that they put hijab on them, not to insult the traditions of Saudi Arabia. And then he danced this famous Saudi dance with sabers together with the king. So it was rather good, but for a while. After it, there were more difficulties. There were some economic relations to build a pipeline, to have some satellite, Saudi satellites launched by Russia. Well, the fact is that in spite of some warming of relations, it was clear understanding in Russian leadership, and I was witness of this, that Russia cannot take the place in the of the United States in the foreign relations of Saudi Arabia. The relations are so close, so interconnected, that it is just another world, and Russia cannot challenge these old relations. But pragmatism meant that there could be understanding. For example, nowadays Russia is not member of OPEC, but still with the understanding with Saudi Arabia to keep oil production not high, they could together keep oil prices on acceptable level. And well, of course, it was with the crisis of oil prices, it was a terrible blow to the economy of all the Gulf countries, including Saudi Arabia. So this cooperation was very important for the two. And for the future, it will be problems, of course. Why? Because I have forgotten the English word, the production of shifts in the United States.
Shale gas.
Well, okay. The new kind of oil production, which was very expensive 10 years ago, now it is more competitive, and the United States will be number one country in oil production, and they want to grab more and more and more of the market, and it's quite natural, it's competition, but of course their part of the market Gulf countries could keep, because it is the cheapest production of oil still here in the world, but here in the Gulf, including Saudi Arabia. So let us return to once more to Syria. Once more, I repeat, I cannot say about everything, you understand. If it is a book about 100 years of Russian policy in the region, you understand that you could have not 40 minutes lecture, but a lot of lectures. So for Russia, Syria, well, Russia was absent from the Middle East in the 90s. In my book, the 90s are called cursed 90s, because there were so many stupidity and naive expectation in foreign policy. Russian elite wanted to become a part of the West without understanding that there is no place for Russia for equal relations with the West. And Russia soon understood that it was cheated, because Gorbachev, a very naive bureaucrats, provincial bureaucrats, he believed on words given to them by the West that there will be no enlargement of NATO near the Russian borders, no inclusion into NATO former Soviet republics, and he believed in it. And Yeltsin also believed in it. But it was clear that Russia is losing a lot and retreating without getting anything in return. So the Middle East was outside of interest of Russia, but being so very important region, Russia had to return in this region to start playing some role of it. It was hope that it will be a role without confrontation with the United States. Well, before coming to Syria, and the example was that after terrorist acts in New York September 2001, it was decision of the United States to intervene in Afghanistan. And maybe you know, maybe not, that Kabul was taken not by American or NATO troops. It was taken by combination of so-called Northern Alliance. It was mistake of translation in my book. It was said North Atlantic Alliance, but Northern Afghan Alliance, which was armed and financed and helped by Iran and Russia. So they took Kabul before American troops coming. Then Russia gave American some logistics for communication with their troops in Afghanistan. There was some cooperation with special services and full stop, nothing more. Well, in Syria, there were all the Russian presence in this country, old traditions, and even in mixed families with Russian wives, half Russian children, they were about 100,000 members of these families. And there was some understanding, well, the regime existed there, but due to the fact that it was always in confrontation with Israel, it was in confrontation with the United States, and Golan Heights were annexed by Israel without international recognition, so regime in Damascus, he tried to reestablish contacts with the West. Bashar Assad visited Paris, and etc. etc. But it was interested in cooperation with Russia, and then after it, with Iran, and so Russia started to broaden cooperation with Syria. Then to say was it considered regime as good or not? You see, even now, but even 10 years before, Russia stopped to pretend that it could be teacher of anything for other countries, to teach democracy, human rights, and something. It should be just pragmatic. So there were some doubts about this regime, but it was an idea that it could transform itself. But after it, there came so-called Arab Spring. Results of Arab Springs, by the way, according to our calculations, Arab world has lost about $1 trillion of economic development. And then this so-called revolutionary movement opened the way for some extremist forces to take power in different parts of the world. And so then, well, for example, in Libya, there was a civil war. It was declared by the Western leaders and by Western media that it was a struggle of democratic forces against bloody dictator. And it was done so strong that, well, for me as an old Middle Eastern, I started, well, I didn't like personally Gaddafi. I met him several times. Well, quite possible that he used force against civil population. But by the way, in the in Britain, there was some work for 5 years. There were two-party foreign relations committee, and then they took the decision that there were no such use of force against civilians in Libya. So the pretext of NATO bombardment were just pretext. So they bombard the way for the opposition to the power, and there is no country. Country is divided into several dozens of armed groupings, bandits or tribes or according to religious things and other things. So that's the results was there. Well, Syria was on the way of this Arab Spring, Arab revolution. Well, the war has started. In January 2012, I participated in Valdai Forum. He took place in Sochi. And I said, what should be our policy to it? 3 points. First, stop the bloodshed. Second, no foreign intervention. Third, Syrians should resolve their problems by themselves. Mr. Bogdanov, who is our deputy in foreign ministry, real Arabist, he knows everything about this region, or practically everything. He was present and said, Alexey, that's okay. He's an old friend of mine. He said, you are quite right. Not because I was so clever, but because I knew the, understood how our policy should look like. And these 3 points were repeated in Russian declarations, proposals for 2 or 3 years, up to a certain point. When there was clear that there is mass foreign intervention in Syria, then Syrian regime invited also some sort of foreign troops, be it Hezbollah or Shia militias, or even more or less regular troops from Iran. And so there was a question how to say about foreign intervention. Then Russia intervened itself, I'll tell about it. And so the question of to speak about stop foreign intervention was very difficult just to propose. But then new points appeared. First of all, territorial integrity of Syria. Now it is declared part of the Russian policy. Then peaceful coexistence between different nationalities, groups, religions, and so on. So it was Russian intervention 2 and something years ago. Why? Well, the problem was the Syrian regime at that time was on the verge of collapse. It was clear 2-3 months more, it could collapse. So just imagine that black banner of Daesh could be put over the Syrian presidential palace. What should be next? I was in Lebanon several times, and Lebanese are quite sure that the next will be Lebanon. Who will be next? Jordan. Who will be next? Excuse me, Saudi Arabia. It was declared officially by the Daesh leaders that the real capital of Daesh is not Raqqa, but Mecca. It's not my imagination. I'd say what they were telling. So from our points of view, well, not our, it's not me, of course, from the point of view of Russian leadership, and it was repeated to me, I have in my book several interviews with Mr. Bogdanov. He said, look, the question was not only to save regime, but to save statehood of Syria, to save dozens of thousands of lives of Syrian people who could be killed in Damascus, to save the cultural heritage of Syria, to save the Syrian civilization. That's why Russia intervened. If not, what could be there? Maybe that's the point of view of Moscow. What are the results? I think, or what were the names? Well, what were the goals? I would like to repeat, and it's a little bit of time, some minutes. First of all, to save regime and at the same time state. To defeat Daesh and other extremist groupings. To find ways and means of military cooperation with the United States, and maybe it was not declared, to broaden this cooperation outside Syria. Well, in military technical aspects, it was achieved. More, not, absolutely not. And then once more to prove, look, of course it was not declared, after so many years of Russian retreating, to show, yes, economically we are not strong enough, though it was some sort of resurgence of Russian economy, but military, if we decide to use military force, we shall use it. It was position of Moscow at that time. Of course, there was some, the world, Western medias, Western leadership were astonished. How could Russia permit such movements? But the fact is, enough was enough for Russia. Whatever could be consequences, it was showed. By the way, the small, now it is much bigger, Cold War started not because of Syria. It started before Maidan or Ukrainian affairs. It was started before Crimea. It was started just at the end of the first decennia, the first 10 years after Putin's speech in Munich. And it was also possibility for Russians, well, it is declared, accepted officially by the Russian military, to train Russian forces to understand what are the weak points, what are stronger points, new weaponry, and all these things. It was also done. So let us say about general results of this situation. You see, what Russian wants in the Middle East? Stability, understanding of the future, bilateral relations, Gulf investment into Russia and some Russian investment to the region, security of the air and pipelines and other things, tourism, well, something like that. And to have some place, some role to play in the region, because economically Russia still cannot be just some opponent for the states, for Europe, for China, for India. Of course, there are possibility, nuclear stations, launching of a satellite, there are possibilities, but still not good enough. If we ask, what are the declared Western goals in the region? Declared goals are the same. So what's the matter? Because it is understood in Moscow, in reality, the Western goals is to humiliate Russia and to kick it out of the Middle East completely. And for this, any new government in Syria, in Libya, in other places could be welcomed. Well, they're extremists, we shall just domesticate them. We shall domesticate them as we domesticated Ikhwan al-Muslimin, for example, in Egypt. So that's why I am not very optimistic about the future. Russia is opened for cooperation, for these very positive steps, but in practice, we see what we saw in the last days, that whatever is not good in the relations, there always Russia should be blamed, or it's always necessary to throw a dead cat on the table just to attract attention in the other ways. So that's, I am just on time, that's it.
Well, thank you very much. Well, thank you, Professor Fazile, for this.